Lady of the Bayou, Monday on evening.
Good evening. We here at Channel 13 are still trying to cope with the shock over the sudden death last night of one of our own, Randy Blair. Randy, or RB as we all called him, died of an apparent heart attack while playing a benefit basketball game at the Woodbourne Community Center. He was pronounced dead at Good Samaritan Hospital after efforts by a Channel 13 photographer and paramedics failed to revive him. Randy was only 32. In the news business, we are forced to deal with death almost on a daily basis. But when it strikes one of your own, the guy sitting next to you, the person you laughed with and shared anguish with over getting the job done, it's that more difficult to accept, and most of all, report about. Gail Gardner shared a lot of those experiences with Randy, and tonight has a special tribute to RB. Gail?
Frank, needless to say, these have been two of the saddest and most difficult days of my life. The sense of loss in a situation like this one is almost too great to bear. We all share it. His family, his friends, his co-workers, and all of you who loved and enjoyed him so much. And what is the hardest of all, I think, is the finality of the situation, knowing we will never see him again in this life. But we can all carry a part of him with us through the years, wherever the future may take us. I know I will.
Hear the words of someone lost in sleep. Dreams live only if you give them to someone. So brush your tears away. Let sunshine have its day.
Randy was that to all of us, a spark of energy at times when things weren't always so bright, a reassuring voice, a soul filled with joy that permeated his whole existence. His arrival at WJZ in 1978 was in a way a homecoming, having grown up in College Park. He could be near the people he loved while doing the job that gave him the most pleasure. This was his first show here, May 27th, 1978.
Now, it gives us a great deal of pleasure to welcome to the weekends our new weekend sports anchor, Randy Blair. And it's very nice to have you.
Richard, I tell you, it's a privilege to be here.
This was a very special man, and it showed in his work. What perhaps stands out the most was his ability to be enthused and excited and involved in anything he set out to do. Involvement was his trademark, whether it was taking a few swings in the batting cage with the Orioles, trying to literally cover an outstanding college receiver, or even putting his body on the line for the cause. Though he possessed extraordinarily good humor, he was capable of strong, heartfelt opinion and expressed it on occasion.
Perhaps King Kuhn is one of the main culprits. As a result of his handling, or lack of it, in this player-owner situation, we might be better to see him with Barnum and Bailey's.
While covering the pro teams, he still always found time for the colleges and the high schools and the kids. They were his favorite.
If you were scoring, what would you give me?
About a one.
A one, that's all?
His own son, Billy, was the light of his life. He kept his desk surrounded with his artwork so he could view the sports world through the eyes of a six-year-old. It's hard to imagine that we will be turning on our television sets and not seeing him every night. He has left a searing, empty space in all of our lives.
Well, you know, you feel so inadequate because words can't express it. And I think probably that a lot of folks, most folks, don't realize how close we are, how closely we work together, what our friendship means to each other. And I was in Boston when I heard the news, and I almost smiled because I said, you know, you really can't joke about that. And so, it'll be tough to come to work Monday. And, you know, I wish I could find the words, but I can't. It's just a great loss.
To think that somebody so young, so genuinely dedicated to his job, And, you know, he spent so many times, he spent hours in here that none of us would dream of doing. And he did it, and did it on a regular basis. To be struck down is just totally incomprehensible. And I think a little unfair. Not that that'll do any good, but if this is not a dream, if this is not a nightmare, then I've lost a very close friend. And we have lost a real professional.
This is just one of the real shocks I've ever had in this business. A fella so active and so young and so talented, and it's God's will, and you just have to hope and pray for Margie and Billy, and that they'll have the strength in the days, months, weeks ahead.
On a professional level, I'm crushed like I've never been crushed before. He was my best friend in Baltimore. We had a lot of good times together. We liked to lift a beer together and talk about our business and our families and our friends. I'm not sure that a lot of people knew the compassion that he had for other people, and I think it was almost fitting that he died helping at a benefit basketball game. He gave of his time willingly, and I'm gonna miss him. And I feel like if you can't cry at the loss of a close friend, you can't cry for anything. So I'm not embarrassed to cry for him. I feel sorry for myself, because I'll no longer be around to make my life happy. And I'll miss him professionally, because he was a standard that we could all try and live up to.
Perhaps the greatest pleasure Randy had was to be able to come on the air and tell us something special about Baltimore. A pennant-winning team headed for the World Series. A boxer winning his first championship fight. A beloved Oriole voted into the Hall of Fame. It is joy he loved spreading, and it is because of this he would probably say, "Do not stand at my grave and weep. I am not there. I do not sleep. I am a thousand winds that blow. I am the diamond glints on snow. I am sunlight on ripened grain. I am the gentle autumn's rain."
A time of innocence, a time of confidences. Long ago it must be, I have a photograph. Preserve your memories, they're all that's left you.
Randy's funeral will be held Wednesday morning, and his family requests that in lieu of flowers, donations be made in his name to the American Heart Association or the Leukemia Society.
Thank you, Gail. And while last night we were all in shock, today, thanks to your package there, the reality of the whole thing has really set in. Eyewitness News will return with the day's stories after this.
Fox always stocks over 1,000 cars and trucks. So when Fox gets overstocked, it's a real problem. And that's the situation now. Fox must reduce inventory to make room for new cars arriving daily. So Fox is having an inventory reduction sale with extra discounts. The selection has never been better, and the price is never lower than now during the inventory reduction sale at Fox, the Chevrolet Auto and Truck Discount Center, a direct factory authorized outlet.
Now, see your dream kitchen come alive at Stewart Kitchens. Stewart Kitchens will custom design your kitchen with quality cabinets by such renowned makers as St. Charles, Quaker Made, J-Wood, Lescare, and Kemper. Your assurance of a well-designed quality kitchen at a competitive price. So make your dream kitchen become reality at Stewart Kitchens. Call or visit Stewart Kitchens showrooms now.
On the next edition of Our Magazine, Gary Collins examines how to protect yourself at home.
If your life or health is in danger and you have to fight, then fight 100% and don't just hurt, but totally incapacitate.
Plus, avoiding childhood dangers. Part one of our three-part series on today's nuns, a life-saving cancer hotline, Alice's Linda Lavin, and more. Our Magazine. We make every hour count.
Monday morning at 10 on Channel 13.
Despite Randy's loss, the news goes on, and tonight 15 guards are being held hostage by inmates at New York's maximum security Ossining prison, better known as Sing Sing. The inmate seized control of a cell block in a five-story building apart from the rest of the prison last night. Since that time, negotiations have been going on with the prisoners, but have been hampered because there is no clear leader. It is believed the hostages are safe, but may have suffered minor injuries in the takeover. A takeover of another sort is happening at a local bank, Fidelity Savings and Loan. The Federal Home Loan Bank Board has taken over six offices of Fidelity, citing mismanagement and financial instability. Four top executives of that bank were fired on Friday. The federal officials say your money is safe there, though, and that's good news, and the bank will open tomorrow as usual. Beginning tomorrow, if you're unemployed, you can look forward to extended unemployment benefits. Laid-off workers in 50 states will receive benefit extensions from 2 to 8 weeks. The extra payments are made possible by the nickel-a-gallon federal gasoline tax hike. State police roadblocks have yet to be challenged on a legal basis by those drivers arrested for drunk driving. But Lisa Champeau says they sure are making some Harford County residents angry.
Calvin Carr wants drunk drivers off the road, but he doesn't approve of the Harford County State Police roadblocks set up last month to randomly check motorist sobriety. Carr has begun circulating petitions asking Governor Hughes to ban the roadblocks. So far, well over 1,000 people have signed them. People like Carr who find the checkpoints unconstitutional, intimidating, inconvenient, and in some cases, ineffective.
It scares the innocent people that have done nothing wrong or intend on doing anything wrong from driving on our highways. And I think people should be able to feel free to go anywhere they please, anytime they please, without the harassment of these things.
If I'm riding down the street, I don't want somebody to be stopping me for no reason at all.
Do you feel that it could be effective in getting drunk drivers off the road?
Not really, because people that are drunk today, if the roadblock is up there, they're going to go someplace else.
I think that the roadblocks are a definite bad precedent. It really smacks of a police state.
Despite the opposition, there are some people who feel the roadblocks are better than nothing.
I am for the roadblocks because I'm against drinking, and I don't like to see drunks out on the road killing innocent people.
Carr will begin sending his petitions to Governor Hughes this week. His hope is that the roadblocks, currently in a 90-day test period, will never become permanent. I'm Lisa Champeau, Channel 13 Eyewitness News.
A federal class action trial begins tomorrow in Kansas City, a trial which makes lawyers say, may make permanent marks on law textbooks. The trial results from the collapse of two walkways in the Kansas City Hyatt Regency Hotel in July of 1981. 1 million documents and more than 200 personal injury and wrongful death suits have been filed in the case, asking $3 billion in damages. One man was killed and 23 others injured in this fuel tank fire in Newark, New Jersey. The fire began back on Friday in the Texaco refinery when gasoline apparently overflowed on a tank and fumes exploded. One of three tanks is still burning tonight. Texaco says they will wait until all tanks are completely out before doing their own investigation. Tonight, oil doesn't seem to be flowing into Baltimore as well as it could be. Maryland port officials report a significant drop in oil imports. Petroleum from foreign ports has fallen from 4.2 million net tons in 1980 to 1.4 million tons last year. But port officials say that although oil imports have dropped, grain exports were up 18% last year, and coal is holding its own. When we return, Tom Davis fills us in on all today's sports, including highlights of the NFL action, playoff action today.
Obviously, it's way off. You want to lose 3,000 ugly pounds? Bring your old car to your nearest Datsun dealer for our biggest year-end celebration ever. We're trimming prices on Datsun Sporty 200 SX and the all-new Pulsar NX. We're stretching your option on the legendary 280ZX and the luxurious Maxima. Now's the time to get the Datsun you've always wanted. We're beating the competition by leaps and bounds. See your nearby Datsun dealers. They're driven to save you money during the sale.
It's a good feeling. We'll bring your days to life. It's a good, good feeling. We make your evenings right. Best of friends, best can be.
It's a good feeling.
Channel 13.
It's a good feeling to know. It's a good feeling.
Channel 13.
It's a good feeling to know.
Day or night, we've got your news. Comedy to cure your blues. Each evening, something new in store. That's what friends are really for.
It's a good feeling.
Channel 13.
It's a good feeling to know. It's a good, good feeling to know.
Tom Davis up now with sports, and Tom, the sports world, sports fans, and all of us lost a good friend.
You know, Frank, we all love to cover sports. I know Randy loved to cover it tremendously. And I know last night I was down at College Park watching the Maryland-Virginia game, and I keep saying to myself after I heard about it, if he was only there, maybe it wouldn't have happened, you know, because he wouldn't have been playing in a basketball game. But the guy's energy and enthusiasm was just, you know, just he constantly had it for life, for sports, for everything.
There must have been a reason.
Well, anyway, we got to do this for the next couple of minutes, so bear with us. Without a doubt, the Steelers and the Chargers played the best football game of the playoffs so far that they've been on since yesterday. San Diego beat Pittsburgh 31-28, scoring two touchdowns in the fourth quarter of today's game at Three River Stadium in Pittsburgh. It was a real passing derby as Dan Fouts threw for 335 yards and three touchdowns. Terry Bradshaw passed for over 300 yards. In fact, it was 326. It was the first Steelers playoff loss since they lost to Miami back in 1972. Let's go to Three River Stadium for the opening kickoff of the game. The drive was capped on Bradshaw's one-yard sneak. Pittsburgh led 14-3 over San Diego, maintained that lead through the end of the first quarter. Led 14-3 when Ken Anderson's second touchdown pass of the game, 2 yards to Dan Ross, but all Cincinnati could score the rest of the way over the final three quarters was a field goal by Jim Breach. Freeman McNeil put on an offensive display, second to none during the playoffs. He'll throw a touchdown pass here, 14 yards to Derek Gaffney, to get the Jets back in the game. McNeil set a playoff record, 211 yards rushing, including a 20-yard score on a sweep to the right side. The game turned into a real rout, though, when Kenny Anderson goes back to pass. Tampa 17, Dallas 16 in the fourth quarter. And Atlanta now leading Minnesota 21-16. That game also in the fourth period of play. And those scores are updates from that. And the matchup Sunday will be the Jets against the Raiders, San Diego against Miami. When we come back tonight at 11 o'clock, we'll have the National Conference matchups. But Frank, Randy will be remembered by all of us for a long, long time.
A long while, indeed. Thank you, Tom. Bill Peoples of Florida returned to his Fort Walton Beach home to find a piece of his ceiling on his bedroom floor. On his bed, he found a warm, 6x8-inch piece of metal. Well, naturally, he assumed it was part of the Soviet satellite now falling to Earth. Not quite so. A young man in the neighborhood had been taking his car for a spin. When he revved up the engine, it exploded, hurtling the fragment 250 yards and through the shingle ceiling. The car had just been tuned. He'd better go back and get it tuned again. When we come back, Ron Riley lets us know whether there'll be white stuff in our forecast, and Lisa Champeau takes us to a celebration for a rebuilt church. So stay with us.
This week, Evening Magazine turns back the clock. Hi, I'm Tim White.
And I'm Donna Hamilton. On Tuesday, play backyard barbarian games with some medieval Marylanders. Also, go on a diet that some people claim cures everything from hives to cancer. Wednesday, see how some people brave the cold and win a place in the sun. Three generations of watermen brave the Chesapeake Bay to see who commands the fastest skipjack.
Thursday, discover how the Wizard of Audio Animatronics breathes life into those Disney World characters. How did a former cameraman for the Buddy Dean Show find fame and fortune in Hollywood with Steve Martin? George Geip tells all. Friday, cruise to a drive-in where roller skating car hops live on and celebrate a Baltimore woman's 105th birthday on Evening Magazine. All this week at 7:30 on Channel 13. The public is invited to fellowship with the Women's Aglobe Fellowship Tuesday at 11 a.m. at the Trinity Assembly of God. For details, phone 426-2327.
A police officer loses his partner and takes out his frustrations on his own son. Kenny steps in to guard the battered child and solve the murder on Charlie's Angels Monday at 4:30. Then at 5:30, Jack's big shot brother pays an unwelcome visit. By winning Chrissy's heart, he makes Jack feel like a loser. On Three's Company, Monday at 5:30 on Channel 13.
It's a good, good feeling to know.
Next up, Ron Riley and the AccuWeather forecast. Ron?
Right. Not going to be much easier to do this tonight than it was last night, but I know if Randy were with us sitting in that seat, he would say something like, go for it. So we're going to go for it. If we're going to complain about the weather today being a little on the murky side, let me reminisce back to a year ago where we had minus 40 for the wind chill factor. Minus 40. And our low this date a year ago was 2 degrees. Today, by those standards, it wasn't very frigid at all. Let's look at the current statistics. On Television Hill, 39 degrees, 70% humidity, northeast wind at 12, the barometer now falling. Our tides, Fort McHenry, high tide at 3:41 in the morning. Our low tide will be at 10:44 tonight. Sunrise tomorrow, almost 7:30, and sunset tomorrow night will be shortly after 5 o'clock. Our Ensign crew was out to Robert E. Lee Park today, and by January standards, it really wasn't too cool a day today. 42 is normal. We got up to a big 4-0, and it was a pretty murky day. Looks like a couple of two more mild but murky days are in the forecast. Satellite sky track from outer space, and here's the latest picture. High pressure right about here, New England. It's moving out to sea, and as it does, it's drawing back a lot of clouds and moisture, filling up the atmosphere from the east. Usually happens as the high moves out and the easterly flow comes in, and that's the moisture we're getting today. What we are waiting for, not really eagerly anticipating, but waiting for low pressure to form up a stationary front right about here, and it could bring us a significant amount of rain by tomorrow evening. Here's the way the map will look at this time tomorrow. It looks relatively complex, not quite as complex as it does appear to be here. The low front should be right about here. We could get anywhere from a quarter to maybe a half inch of rain tomorrow night and into Tuesday morning, and maybe some patchy fog during the day. Behind it will be a cold front, but the temperatures are, again, relatively mild behind it, so we won't really have a cold front per se. Temperatures will moderate, but they still will stay just a little bit on the warm side for a couple of days. Back to the west, there still is another cold front to come down, and that one, bringing some chilly air, could affect us where it would end up getting fairly cold and very blustery by the middle of the week. It'll be a change, because with our 40s today and in the 30s by the middle of the week with sunshine, we're going to feel like maybe it's January, but only maybe. The state map shows temperatures with drizzle around us, 39 degrees, we said, in Baltimore, 41 in D.C. now. Out in the mountains, they are having some snow flurries. The snow and sleet that was in the forecast mostly is staying to the north, and it's melting. Northern York County, P.A., out toward Cumberland, they had some reportedly in Harford County. But tonight, it's going to be basically rain and drizzle, and tomorrow, more the same. Okay, the temperature's out to the west, a little bit warmer in the 40s. The AccuWeather forecast for the next 5 days. Tomorrow, another gloomy one, but mild with 49-degree readings. Tuesday, we'll get some rain in the morning, clearing in the afternoon as the cold front approaches. Then Wednesday, Thursday, it'll be both 39 degrees. Friday, some sunshine with a slight chance of a shower in 42. Frank?
Thank you, Ron. Finally tonight, the story of a Southwest Baltimore church congregation who rallied after their parish hall was destroyed by fire over a year ago. Well, this afternoon they formally opened the new hall and they helped to build, and Lisa Champeau was there.
After fire destroyed their activities hall for the second time in September of 1981, the parishioners of St. Jerome's Catholic Church pulled together and helped rebuild a new hall by raising $40,000.
They threw benefits. We had two fire dances. We had a luau. We've had several bingos. And also just with their manpower, they've tried to help.
The new hall means a lot to the 300-plus active parishioners who helped celebrate its opening.
Well, I've been here since the first grade, and I've been in this parish all my life. And when it burned down, this is the second time. It kind of hurt, because I know a lot of activities and all go on here, and this reopening, it's like, it's just, you know, it's the greatest thing that happened here right now.
St. Jerome's, which sits in the heart of Southwest Baltimore, serves a varied community, and the new hall is expected to bring the community together again outside of Sunday Mass.
it's like a big family. Everybody is so nice, and, you know, and I've been a member here for quite a few years.
Not being able to use this for the last 16 months has been very difficult on them, but they've worked together. We've gone other places to have the affairs, but they've all kept saying, we've got to get back into our hall. And today we're back in our hall. And it's just a beautiful day. I think everybody is just bubbling. I know I am.
St. Jerome's not only celebrated the opening of its new hall today, but its anniversary as well. 95 years here in Southwest Baltimore. I'm Lisa Champeau, Channel 13 Eyewitness News.
And that's our report for the moment. For the entire Eyewitness News team, I'm Frank Luber, back tonight at 11.
Little Joy nearly lost her life when she had chicken pox. Complications killed most of her skin and cut off the circulation to her legs. She ended up losing her left foot and her right leg. But you sure can't tell it from her happy, spunky spirit. She is a true joy, and you'll meet her on Monday's People Are Talking. Later in the week, learn how to make love to each other. Hear the tragic story of a death caused by a television program. And get a diet that insists you eat sweets and starches. Channel 13's People Are Talking, weekdays at 9.
Every child has a right to a good education. But some handicapped children can be denied that right because they're without the support that their own parents can provide. You can help. Become a parent surrogate. Just see to it that a child receives an education